So, I guess when it comes down to it, we should talk about what the hell this thing is, really, because this is going to be a bit of a, I guess it's almost like a podcast, kind of.
Yeah.
Not really, maybe.
In a way, it's like a podcast. It's like a just discussion between friends, you know?
Indeed.
Yeah.
We're going to talk about the direction for Destiny in the next couple of months, talk about what the future may hold, and, you know, provide some speculation. We should go ahead and preface this, that some of this is very much, you know, dialogue based on educated opinions and educated guesses, but some of it is also just going to be like us spitballing things. There's no leaks in this. There's no nutter like that. So, yeah, if we say something here and it happens to be true, that's just very lucky for us. And if we say something here and it's complete nonsense, then that's why. So, yeah, we'll be able to look back on this in a few years and just be like, hey, you remember that time when we were wrong?
Remember that time we were completely stupid about this?
And then we said that it was going to be like a text-to-speech adventure tied up in a love story. Like, nah, dude. Nah, they just gave us another first-person shooter campaign. I can't believe it, man.
We said, you know, Eververse was going to get a fully fleshed-out storyline. There was going to be Master Chief involved. And then all of
exploring
a sudden,
exploring with Fenchurch, like, all of these things. No.
I bet Fenchurch is a wonderful person. You know? Just
I think he's going to be like the Lando Calrissian of the entire Destiny universe, basically.
Right?
And we just never get to see him. But when we do, we're going to be like,
okay, like, wow. Exactly. Like, took us like 6 years. But, you know, hey, you look good.
I still like want a moment where if that happens, we see Fenchurch. And then he just completely ignores Tess, like just completely bypasses his daughter to talk, or not his daughter, his niece, to talk to the guardians that have just shown up, being like, "Oh, hey, you're way cooler. Let's talk to you. Hey, how you doing, buddy?"
Oh my god!
Like all of this nonsense.
Yeah, exactly.
Anyway, where should we start first with this, I guess? That's the real question.
So I think the first thing people probably want to know is, hey, Evan and Bife, where the hell are we going this fall? And why is everybody talking about the darkness like it's just gonna happen? You know, why is everybody saying that the pyramids, the ships, the veil, whatever you want to call them, the Doritos, if you want to get that specific, why are they coming? What is the main signs that has everybody saying, okay, it's for sure this fall and not like a Destiny 3 or like multiple years down the road?
And aside from there's some of the obvious stuff here, clearly, and then there's been like the subtler signs throughout. We're gonna go ahead and talk about that. Like, everybody has seen the Dorito Rasputin Doomsday Clock.
Yep.
I think you'd struggle to find someone who doesn't know what that's all about, especially considering that, you know, we have weekly updates on this nonsense. Having said all of that, they've been signposted and telegraphed for a very long time. And this is before even Shadowkeep, you know? So we've had some signs of this, and there has been some knowledge. I think one of the earliest things, of course, is not just the ending of the Destiny 2 campaign, because that, again, is a bit too obvious. But I think one of the first points at which we saw that stuff was really starting to heat up was probably going to be in Forsaken and the expansions that followed for the rest of the season past that year. And wow, I am
what happens.
In case you're wondering, this is not B-roll. This is all live, ladies and gentlemen. So when I die to geometry and fail at things, yeah, that's gonna happen. But no, the first real time was at which we started getting signposting and stuff for this happened, I think at least, in Black Armory. Now I should really clarify this, because this is something that Bungie does. And it's something that you'll know if you've been in the community for years and years and years, but it's something that only people who are really digging very deep into the game will notice. If you see something happen in the lore and it's a topic which has potential relevance to the future, but maybe not something which immediately appears right now, that is often Bungie telling you, watch this space, there will be a story here.
Yep.
So everything to do with Aldrin is probably signposting for a future story, considering that, yeah, the Vanguard Dare is unfulfilled and everything like that. Anything to do with the darkness is also stuff that fills in that void. And there's been really fantastic examples of this in the past. Forsaken was probably the first time that we saw all of this really get fleshed out with Destiny 2 in mind. So yep. Forsaken had been telegraphed all the way since back since Curse of Osiris, right? You had the Telesto, which had been added in the Curse of Osiris expansion, and that had a lore tab on it. And the lore tab of Telesto is all a bunch of gibberish, right? It's a lie. The important thing about it is that it is specifically to Paladin Auron, which is basically an awoken code of trying to communicate a hidden message. The first letter of every word in the paragraph forms a new sentence. And that sentence is the information that the Awoken are basically trying to tunnel through everything and secretly get out there between themselves. And that kind of brought back this notion that, you know, Aldrin was alive. And this was before Forsaken had even happened. You then had Young Ahamkara's grasps. And not Young Ahamkara's grasps.
The sealed Ahamkara's grasps.
Yes, the silver Hunter exotic.
The ones that we thought were going to be broken before Shadowkeep, because they were giving us all, they were giving all the auto reload thing again. Yeah.
The only thing that could still give you obnoxious auto reload.
Pretty much.
Hi, welcome to this game.
I was like, hey,
still broken.
I know you want to take away auto reload, but maybe look at this thing that's going to completely break the next raid if you.
Indeed. Oh, thank God that that was actually taken out in time, even if it's through a quick hot fix. But yeah, no, like that basically gave us a lore tab that indicated vaguely what was going to happen. You know, it spoke about how it was going to tell us two truths and a lie. And it basically told us, you know, the prince of the Awoken, or the prince sends his regards, and light fades within the prison, and one other nebulous statement about the queen. And, you know, two truths in that: light does fade within the prison, Cade died. And as for the rest, you know, it all played out accordingly. I need to remember what the third statement is in that lore tab, but it's been a very long time since I read it. All of that leads us basically to the point that, yeah, Bungie signposts things. It's the general point of all this, right? They signpost things. They give us an idea of what's happening. They will talk about future expansions. They will very much push us to this place where they're giving us all the facts that we might want or need.
Oh, no. We have turned
it. Oh, we're doing this, are we? Okay, no. Right. But yeah, they give us the signs and the facts they need, and they tell us everything we may need to know about the expansion before it actually happens. So yeah, all of that brought back to the Darkness story. They've been doing it for quite some time. They have, to the best of my knowledge, the first like real contemporary one was the Black Armory, right? You had the Black Armory lore, which describes the collapse and describes the actual like feeling and process of what it was like to live through that, right? Mm-hmm. So it describes the creatures of the darkness and how there was this howling, organic, bestial, metallic thing that attacked them in their bunker, right? So that's the first real hint that we got to it. You know, I say that and I'm a complete liar. It has been in Forsaken because, yeah, the beginning of the Awoken's origin story is literally them being attacked by a pyramid ship.
Yep.
And that's the first like telegraph towards the darkness's power. They have like gravitational weaponry, which is used to completely and utterly like shred apart everything on a molecular level. And they unleash it on this ship, and it's not good. Like, everybody is in big trouble. You know, this is ultimately what leads to the Awoken becoming the Awoken, is this event where they just have to sit there and say, like, hey, we demand that we are treated as a separate species. We are not from Earth, you know?
Exactly.
And it's where this mythos of, like, the Covenant of Light and Dark comes from. But, you know, that's their first encounter. Like, they've been telegraphing that. And then the real big one came in Season of the Drifter, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the Invitations of the Nine.
Well, I was even going to go even further back, right? Like, one of the biggest ones, which I thought was very ballsy of Bungie to do, was in the throne world, or in the throne room of Mara. Like, if you made it to, the third week, or not even the third week, like 9 weeks in, you could see a pyramid hologram on the table in Mara's throne room. Like, that was a huge implication of, like, oh, where is Mara gone? She's not here right now. And then, boom, there's a pyramid. And then our ghost just goes, ah, what a queen. And then she comes back next week and is like, excuse me? You want to say that? Mm-hmm. Don't ever talk about your queen like that again, ghost. Like, so it's that was pretty cool. And I feel like that is another, like, really big sign that stuff was coming.
Indeed.
They do a really good job of dropping things. If anybody's ever curious as to when Bungie is going to drop something or what they're going to drop or what they're going to talk about. Always, and I mean always, first of all, watch Bife. And then secondly, always just look through the little context clues that they put in the game. I mean, you can go even as far as Eververse on some of these context clues, right? Like we just talked about. Eververse tells us everything. They do.
Ships generally, but even back in Forsaken, they were telegraphing Shadowkeep.
You know? Exactly.
Like there was the unfinal, was it final or unfinal shapes? I'm going to open my collections in this and see right now, because it will be under equipment ships season 4, I believe. Yeah, Unfinal Shapes, there it is. This was a ship that got released, and it was from the perspective of Eris Morn, and it was talking about her and the Queen basically going out into the universe and trying to investigate more about the Hive. And this is a thing that's expanded on in the pre-Shadowkeep lore, and it leads us ultimately to Shadowkeep, where Eris finds a pyramid. You know, like, this is not unconnected, it's not some nebulous piece of storytelling that's just lost in the backdrift. Like, this leads to the main story arcs that you guys will all play in the campaign on day one. You'll play in the raids later down the line. Like, all this stuff matters. It is relevant to the story that's being told. So it's absolutely have you seen that happen before?
There
it is. Where the ships suddenly ignore gravity and the laws of physics generally.
Oh, I've seen it where the ship goes through the floor completely. And it's just you know.
Yeah, that just happened on my screen. Like, it got punted in by the harvester.
Well, one of the biggest things that I will always tell people is, if you want to know what is coming, literally just open up your tab or whatever and go to your store and just look through some of the names of the ornaments, look through some of the names of the transmats, look through all of that and piece together some kind of context clues as to what could be potentially coming. Now, sometimes you can't trust everything, obviously, and you can't take it on face value and go, okay, I'm going to run with this and that's going to be what's coming next. You can't do that. But what you should do is look through it, look at the names of these things, look what they are meaning to tell you and break them down, and then you will get something out of it. Like, one of the biggest things for me is all this speculation with Siva, which I don't know if Siva's coming back or not. I have no clue. But one of the biggest speculations was due to this season's transmats, right? It says War Set Arrival. Well, this season is about Rasputin, so that makes sense. Cabal Entrance. Well, the Cabal are crashing the Almighty into the tower, or they're trying to crash the Almighty. And then, Siva Emergence is the next one. So what does that have to do with this season? Well, we now have this weird quest called The Lie, and I have no clue what else has to do with that. But I, just based off of that, like, there could be something there.
Mm-hmm. For reference here, there's also a point we should make, which is that, like, we're totally not going to talk about spoilers, so I'm sure there's a guy in the comments section who's like, hey, I'm going to peddle you the thing.
Hey, I know, it's like, we know that there's, like, spoilers. We don't know what the spoilers are, per se, but we don't want to talk about spoilers until they actually release.
Yeah.
It's like, just on, like, an honor thing, I guess. I don't know. Mm-hmm. Our own self-pride.
We have curated content for you guys, and we are very sure that we don't want to go ahead and breach that trust with regards to some of you who would rather go into this stuff blind, you know?
Exactly.
Like, yeah. Either way, is what it is. All of this stuff has indeed telegraphed all the way to the darkness. And this has culminated in, I think, the ending to the Shadowkeep campaign, where you see multiple pyramid ships saying, you know, we will arrive soon. Don't fear
we
us.
Are we are salvation. Your salvation. Yep.
Which, you know, very telling. Very ominous.
You got the raid that is an actual teaser for pyramid ships. When you beat the darkness infested what's the boss's name? Why am I struggling on the boss's name?
Sanctified
Mind? Yeah, Sanctified Mind. Yeah. When you beat Sanctified Mind, is Sanctified Mind not a darkness infested, like, ancient X technology, right? Isn't that what he is?
So it's kind of out on the, like, fringe of what we know, because the Vex of the Black Garden and the Vex, they're generally are really mysterious. But there's a lot of indications that he's similar to the original, like, three main story bosses that could be found during the original campaign of Destiny 1, right? So when you look at some of them, you'll notice that they are starting as just stone statues, and then they turn into metallic Vex that are covered in plants. Meanwhile, you have the Sanctified Mind, which starts as this metallic Vex, which, yeah, is still covered in plants and lichen and all that nonsense. But at the end, when he dies, he doesn't fall over and explode. He turns into a statue, you know?
Yep.
So and, that's cool things.
And then
I mean,
the pyramid he's on top of them, literally yeah,
like
comes
he's
out.
On top of the mesa. A pyramid appears when he dies. And I mean, like, you know. Like,
and you go underground
it's
what's
filled out practically.
Yeah. Like what is sitting there underground? Oh, the same statue that you saw at the end of Shadowkeep campaign where you picked up the artifact.
You know, like little things. Again, context clues, as you were saying.
Context clues are everything in this game. They do a really good job of environmental storytelling for the future of what's to come, I guess. Right? Like some people are gonna get it, others are not gonna pay attention to it, but we're trying to just steer everybody in hopefully the right direction. I mean, this
indeed. And of course, there's also something that we should mention here, which is the Titan emblem. So in the last few days, Titan's world emblem and patrol emblem that you can unlock just from doing content on the planet has changed from being there permanently to having a timer on it saying, what is it? Limited time to acquire it, basically?
Yep. Limited time only. Offer. Yeah.
Yes. And so the big point about that is basically that with Titan now having this mysterious change to its emblem, we can look at more context clues and talk about the fact that the darkness has screwed up Titan before, right? So to give you an idea, there is a book that we unlocked in Shadowkeep called Last Days on Kraken Mare. And Last Days on Kraken Mare is the closest we get to a first-hand account of the attack of the darkness, right? It goes through this crazy sort of 12-hour stretch, I believe. Maybe it's slightly longer than that, but a very short stretch of time where they attempt to evacuate the arcologies of Titan. Rasputin and some exos under his command come in and effectively cause as many problems as they try to solve. And then the darkness unleashes its major weapon, which again is to do with gravity. What it effectively does is it starts to pull Titan apart, right? So it starts by pulling Titan on a pair of polar opposite locations, and it starts to change it from a sphere into more of a, into something closer to a cylinder. Not an exact cylinder. What am I looking for? It's like an oblong shape. Yeah. So this is a problem in the first place, because again, that's editing the gravity of the planet. It's making it very unstable and will cause, you know, ultimately major problems when it all gets ripped to pieces. Then the gravitational waves stop and it falls back into a spheroid shape. And the problem with that is it releases this massive wave, right? This crazy wave of Titan's methane oceans, which, you know, effectively imagine a tsunami, but just
methane.
Way bigger.
Yeah. Like, and yeah,
way larger. We're talking about 50, 40 foot storm swells. Sorry, meters even. So it's, you know, you're looking at something like 150 feet. This is no small wave. This is something that would tower over buildings. They would literally engulf the arcologies. So that's the kind of weapons that the darkness is able to bring to bear. And that is something that could very well happen to Titan again. But, you know, there's a lot of questions about the extent of that weapons. Like, what if instead of pulling on either end of the planet and then letting go, what if the darkness just keeps pulling, right? Because eventually, that's going to mean you pull a planet apart, or in this case, a moon, you know?
Right. And Titan, you know, we say moon is in like, oh yeah, it's a moon, but a moon is still much bigger than...
Titan is still like is the largest moon in the system. Like Titan is comparable to Earth. You know, this is no small body.
Titan is much bigger than Earth, I think, right? It's Titan. Like people, whenever they hear the word moon, they associate it with like our moon and like, oh, that's tinier than Earth. Wow, it's going to be a tiny place. No. Some moons are like 50 times the size of Earth, hundreds of times. You know what I mean? Like some of these are gigantic.
I need to double check again, because I did say Titan was the largest in the system, but I can't remember whether it's Titan or Ganymede.
I think Titan was like known to be for a while, at least. That's like my teaching. Like when I was in school, it was like known to be, but I have no clue.
I'm sure one of my buddies who studies astronomy is going to go ahead and kick down my door and be like, well, this is the fact.
Can you tell your buddy, can you ask your buddy who studies astronomy about what the heck is going on in the vault of Last Wish? I bet he had a fun time, you know?
Mm-hmm. Oh God, I tell you, big brain strats needed to work that stuff out. That's crazy.
Yeah. Oh man. So not only that, but let's go to the fairly more obvious as well. Let's talk about the fact that in the Rasputin bunker on Io, not only can you see the Doritos coming into our solar system, they are progressing each week. They are making it to new places and they are moving closer and closer. And I believe this next week or 2 weeks from now, they should be hitting Jupiter. Saturn or Jupiter. I think one of those two. So it's closing in, like they are getting closer and closer. And it's this season that they're moving in big strides because we awoke them on the moon. Like they know where we are fully. They've known where we are since the end of Vanilla Campaign, but on the moon especially is like the calling for, oh yeah, now they're officially coming.
It's like we this was a threat in the back of our minds. Like we knew we were going to do this at some point. We just didn't realize it was like right here and now.
Right.
You know,
Season of Dawn is mostly to do with the Cabal, but is there any big implications from Season of Dawn? Because I can't think of any off the top of my head other than Osiris, and we'll get to Osiris in a second. Is there any like visual things in game that we got to see, or is it mostly just lore for Season of Dawn? Because I don't remember seeing.
It's mostly lore, and it's not too much of it, to be completely honest. There's one or two like moments in, it's the Constellations lore book, where there's actually a note from one of the speakers, because that's a lore that needs to be get on into. The speaker that we see in game is one of multiple speakers that used to exist. And basically, the Constellations lore book notes something that one of the speakers experienced where he lived through the collapse. And it also notes the voice of the Traveler, because the speakers could actually hear the voice of the Traveler, supposedly. And it notes the voice of the Traveler describing what the darkness consuming the system is like. And it's really, like, honestly, if you need to read a lore book and get more context on the light, Constellations is where you should go. It's fascinating and not enough people talk about it.
Okay.
So, yeah, go ahead and do that. But aside from
Constellations,
that, relatively thin on references.
Gotcha.
I think what seems very clear is that the darkness will take center stage in the next big expansion. But I think there's also a whole load of other storylines that are revolving around this, you know? It's like when Bungie, for example, jumped in with Forsaken, it wasn't just a story about the Scorn and their barons. It ended up also being a story about Riven and the Taken, and to a much lesser extent, the Fallen. But, you know, you had all of this bound up in a location that was to do with the Awoken of the Reef. And that means that we've definitely got the context of, if there's going to be a major expansion, you're probably going to expect multiple enemies to go along
at the minimum too, right? Like let's look at the Taken King. You know, the Taken were the big, I mean, it's in the title, right? The Taken are the big enemy. They're new to the game, but who else is there? A lot of the Cabal are there. A lot of the Hive are there. It's a lot to do with all three of those. Exactly.
When you look at Shadowkeep, it's a Hive expansion. Yeah, the darkness are kind of there. But also, like, the thing that's the connective tissue for them is the darkness. And them is referencing not just the Hive, but also the Vex of the Black Garden.
Yes.
So, like, exactly. There's this common thread. And the real question ends up being, like, what are the two key races that you're going to see in this expansion?
Give me one second. My garage is doing fun thing.
You're all good.
Yeah.
I think the
major answer to that question is to just once again, let's look at some of the context clues. Like, first of all, one of the things that I want to point out is just from a game perspective, like, okay, what makes the most sense for an enemy that we haven't seen that we haven't fought in a while, right? Like let's go on the basic, like, okay, without the lore, what's an enemy we haven't like fought as our main enemy in a while? The first one that comes to my mind is the Fallen, because outside of Black Armory, there hasn't been anything to do with the Fallen that much. I mean,
we had 0 hour from like one mission in the campaign style setting of Season of the Drifter, and then the Fallen have had like small bits of lore here and there. I don't really count them as a major enemy this season because it has been the Cabal.
And yeah,
they may have been in a lot of the promotional stuff, but I don't count them as being a major thing when they were just in some of the Legendary Lost Sectors. That doesn't cut it for me.
Nope.
So yeah, I'd agree with that. I think Fallen is quite likely.
Fallen is quite likely, but let's start.
If I may as well, I feel like Taken. Because Taken has been a hot minute, you know? Like, Forsaken is very much the last time that we saw them in force, aside from also in Shadowkeep's One Strike, which was the...
The Festering Core.
Now, I put a little pin in that, because wherever the Taken go, as far as we know right now, it's also very likely that Savathun is roaming. Having said that, the Taken are creatures of pure darkness. So I don't want to go ahead and say that this is absolutely the case, because it could very well be that we'll only ever see the Taken again if we see Savathun herself or another very powerful Ascendant Hive who has somehow been able to take control of them, which I doubt exists.
What about Cebu Arath or Cebu Arash? I feel like I'm messing up so badly, but you get my point.
So Cebu is one of those other interesting tangents in the lore. Like, I think people see her as like the inferior little sister to Oryx and Savathun.
She's not the goddess of war?
Exactly. Like, it's very much not the case. She doesn't get spoken about a lot, but honestly, I feel like she's a way more likely character to see in the future rather than Savathun. And that sounds crazy to people because of all the signposting that we've gotten. But I think that Savathun is such a big villain that when it comes down to it, they need to develop an entire game and an entire response to her that is as old, like whole consuming as the Taken King expansion was.
Right.
You know? I feel like we're not due that for a very long time. So if there is going to be a more minor Taken presence, and if Savathun has allowed some extent of control for Cebu Arath, which I doubt, there is a possibility of that happening there. To give you an idea of where the power dynamics are, though, in one of the weekly story missions that you can get in the Dreaming City, I believe this is in the second week, you actually face the sons and daughters of Cebu Arath as Taken Knights, which is very telling because, generally speaking, this is something that happens whenever there is a moment of like power contention within the ranks of the Hive and the Taken. So to give you the best example, Moloch was taken by Oryx, and Moloch is Savathun's son, you know? It's Oryx's nephew in this crazy, silly, extended
This family is gigantic.
This family needs to quit.
This family, there's so many of them, and we just keep butchering them, you know?
Right.
Hash Ladoon, gone.
Mm-hmm. It's like, look, we've literally killed your grandfather and your father and your mother. Would you like to stop, please?
It's time to stop, Sabbath. Yeah.
But yeah, like,
I just don't see Taken coming this fall, because there has been nothing. Like, that's the thing, is once again, context clues will tell you everything, and there's been almost nothing about the Taken for this fall outside of Festering Court, my knowledge.
Right, which is why it's one of those, like, we haven't seen it in a long time, but I don't think it's likely kind of moments.
Exactly.
By that same extent, you know, I think the important thing, I'm pretty sure you were about to go into this, is to talk about potential locations, right?
Yeah, I was gonna say, before we do that, we should probably, because we just said why the Taken probably aren't going to be a thing, even though we haven't seen them in a while, but why the Fallen? We should probably say why we're talking about the Fallen.
Okay, so one of the big reasons for going into the Fallen storyline, as well as having the lack of time since they've been spoken of, and also in terms of it just making a little bit more sense in terms of like developing all the stories in tandem, is because there's a lot of stuff that's been going on in the background of the Fallen. And again, with these context clues, it's very easy for us to see that they may well have a lot of story to be told. And the big threads that can all be pulled on realistically can be summed up in one lore book that you find in the Season of the Drifter. Like, if there's one thing that you find, go into your lore triumphs. Look into, I believe it's the Stolen Intelligence lore books, which I think you can find in Dusk and Dawn. I'm going to go ahead and check. Actually, it's in the Light. And I want you to go ahead and look through all of these, because they're all good. But generally speaking, you're looking for the Outliers lore book whenever you're looking for the Fallen. And this entire thing basically just goes through how the Fallen presence has evolved over the last few years, and it goes through quite a few really key personalities within the Fallen hierarchies and different Fallen commanders that are vying for control of the race as a whole. And this outlines several really key points. First of all, the Fallen, for the most part, are fractured. The houses are gone. The houses are dead. The Kells have died. The Archons have died. The High Servitors, for the most part, are gone, right? And so this means that the Fallen as a race are fractured, and there is a huge power vacuum. For the moment, it's tentatively filled, at least at the beginning of D2, this is much more true, it's tentatively filled by the House of Dusk. And this is not a traditional house, you know? This didn't migrate to the system along with the House of Kings and the House of Devils and the House of Winter. This came out of sheer necessity and out of houses banding together so they could live, right? So this is very much a new creation. There's even a new generation of Fallen that have grown up without the influences of the house that is, generally speaking, not in touch with their old cultural ways. You know, when Varix talks about the ways of old, it's very much partly because of the fact that his people have forgotten those old ways. So when you look at the context there and you drive it forward with the logical point of what's going to unite the Fallen, a lot of it is a big thing of trying to reclaim their old culture. And right. There's really three different groups or three different leaders that are trying to do that. And those leaders are Varix, Mithrax the Forsaken, and Eremis, right?
Yes. So
I think, where do we start with this? I think everybody's heard of Varix, right?
Everyone's like Varix, heard of Varix. Our guy, you know, that left the Prison of Elders, our guy that was the Kel... Or not, sorry, not a Kel, my bad. He was the voice of the Prison of Elders for the people that maybe don't read the lore that often, but kind of know of Varix or have heard the name. He was the guy that said, Psylocke, the Defiled, you know, really loud.
Kexis, the Betrayed.
Yeah,
like, very loud boy, but also one of the most fantastic vendors of Destiny 1, because it was the first time we'd ever interacted with a friendly Fallen.
Exactly.
Right? So this was, for any Destiny 1 players, you'll remember, but for people who are new to Destiny 2 in any regard, this was a really iconic character. So he's very well remembered. But the lore behind him actually sets him up now in Destiny 2 as more of an antagonist, and also as somebody who has taken an opportunistic stance out of the general dismay and mishap that's come out of the system. And this all starts back in the Taken King. To give you a small little summary of things, the reason why Mara being alive in Forsaken is so remarkable is because in the Taken King, she died. This throws the Awoken hierarchy into chaos. And Varix has an entire lore book called Most Loyal, where he just goes through all of these details and what happened and recounts the story all the way up until he starts the riots that erupt in the Prison of Elders and release Uldren and the Barons. And I mean, like, let me be really clear about this. He starts this. He makes this happen. This was his move. This was his action, right? So this was not some weird, like, moment where he had, you know, some circumstantial point at which he was betraying someone. No, like, this is very much his choice to do this. And the repercussions of that are huge for the Awoken and huge for us because we lose Cade. But bigger than all of that, I think now, is his impact with the Fallen. He is one of the last Fallen that was alive during the time of the Whirlwind. He's one of the last Fallen that truly remembers what they would call the old ways. And he takes his ether supplies from the Prison of Elders during the escape, and he grows massively in size. For those of you who don't know, when Fallen consume ether, they literally grow. And it's why Kells and Captains are bigger than your typical dregs or wretches. He basically anoints himself as a Fallen Kell. And he says, House Judgment is going to lead everybody back to the old ways. We are going to be the ones who are worthy of the title of leadership and worthy of the Great Machine again.
I always think of Varix in that situation of, like, you ever play Batman Arkham Asylum?
It's been a while.
But like the Joker at the end when he's like just gigantic. That's what I'm thinking Varix is going to be next time we see him. Just like this absolute beefcake.
He's going to be a very thick boy.
Kind of building off of that, too, for people who didn't play Destiny 1, but kind of want to know what Varix is all about, like what was he like? Even back then, we didn't fully trust. I don't know how to explain this. Like, we didn't really fully trust him back then either. He always sounded, at least to me from listening in game, he always sounded like, okay, this guy He's
a bit sketch.
Yeah, right? He's a bit sketch. Like he doesn't sound like he's disliking what these fallen Kells are doing and like Skolas. He doesn't hate Skolas. It's like he's so impressed by Skolas's ability to do these things, to try to unite or try to take over and just try to establish a mega dominance over the Vex and use their technology.
The genius of Varric's writing is where it makes the line between whether there's empathy and admiration for something or whether there's acknowledgement of superiority for something very thin, right? It's very blurred.
Yes.
So whenever Varric is talking about how Skolas, the antagonist of the House of Wolves, is trying to accomplish the scheme of the Kell of Kells or the prophecy of the Kell of Kells, he always talks of it with a little bit of reverence almost. And he's almost like, oh, that's impressive. Like, he's going after this. That's okay. Well, it's a little bit of a crazy strategy. He even says Skolas is quite mad. But you can tell there's a little bit of reverence and there is a little bit of respect that comes from that, you know?
Yeah. I mean, it's one of those things where I feel like Varric is almost like, if I was in that position of Skolas, I would do this or I would do it. It's like he's constantly scheming. He's like the little finger of destiny.
You know what? That's such an appropriate analogy. That's honestly, that is, because he's constantly betraying people, you know, like he betrayed Skolas back in the time when he sold him out to Mara at the end of the Reef Wars and became, quote unquote, Varric the Loyal, which is actually a term of scorn from the other fallen. Right. But when it comes down to it, he also betrayed Mara and the Reef. You know, he went off and became his own house, effectively, and rallied a bunch of fallen to his cause. So, yeah, he's opportunistic, and calling him the little finger of all this is really appropriate, I think.
So, I think that Varric being not the same as a lot of people remember him, or like at least not friendly, like a lot of people have this idea of him. I think that's going to be a really interesting potential avenue that they could go down. And I think, once again, that's like one of the reasons for this whole fallen thing is there's a lot of chaos going on. You have all of the houses are pretty much either non-existent or, I mean, new houses are being started. You have Mithrax, who is completely betrayed everything that is known to be fallen. Like, you know, the Traveler left the fallen, but yet Mithrax still wants to help Guardians because of some kind of purpose that he feels obligated to do it.
So we should probably talk a little more about Mithrax.
Yeah.
He's character 2 out of 3 in this entire equation.
100%.
And I think that he's like, I'm really excited about Mithrax.
Mithrax is the most interesting character I think ever made in Destiny. I say that knowing fully well that Oryx is a great character too.
Right? Like there's a ton of great characters throughout the entirety of it. You know, you read through all of Aldrin's story, it's fantastic. You read through what Varric has had written about him, it's really good.
Yep.
As you say, Oryx the Taken King. Absolutely phenomenal story told throughout the Books of Sorrow and through all sorts of other things. Even the small stories that we get about Nokris present really interesting ideas of what it is to be heretical in the society of the Hive. You know, Mithrax tops all of that because it's this moment that I think is comparable. And we were talking about this just before we started our recording. But Mithrax is comparable to the Arbiter in Halo 2.
Exactly.
And I think that's really fantastic, not only because of the fact that he's making real strides and making, in many senses, quite a lot of sacrifices and going out on a limb because of the fact that a Guardian at one point decided to spare his life. Spoiler alert, it was you. And if you've not played Titan's story, you should go back and do this right now. I can't believe we didn't think of this.
Yes, go back and do Enemy of My Enemy. That's the quest. It's for the Rat King. Go and do that. It's the Titan heroic quest. Go do it.
But basically, you see Mithrax in that thing, and there is a secret ending to this. If you are so inclined about spoilers, then go ahead and just mute us for the next 30 seconds. But I expect that most of you have been there already. But in this secret ending, if you decide to only kill the Hive Knight that's fighting Mithrax, Mithrax will not then attack you and he will just bug out. And you will have effectively spared his life because it was this moment at which you were able to stop him from being murdered and you showed him a little bit of mercy, a little bit of grace. And that really goes on to impact his storyline. There's a whole bunch of different lore cards and lore tabs that mention him from that point on. Both the Lord of Wolves and the Queenbreaker exotics both of them mention the adventures of Varix fighting alongside a hunter and a warlock in a fire team. And, you know, not only is that cooperation between Fallen and Guardians, which is...
Oh, did you mean Mithrax, not Varix, right?
Yeah, I see. Sorry, that's me.
No, you're good, you're good, you're good.
But yeah, no, not only is that an amazing sign of cooperation, but it's also this moment where we get a lot more context on what Mithrax plans to do. And I think it's in the Queenbreaker lore tab itself where this phenomenal little moment happens where Mithrax finds the grave of Sir Ido, who originally captured him and almost, you know, could have killed him, but effectively spared him again. You know, he finds the grave, takes a moment, and gives a little bit of a remorseful stand of vigil for her because, you know, she's lost to us at the moment. And then after everything is said and done, he has this moment where he says that he will gather effectively the open-minded Fallen and he will be their Kel. And he effectively starts the House of Light with these two Guardians as his witness. And that is such a cool moment in the story. You have this sudden expansion of what everyone believed the Fallen could be for the longest time, because let's be real, everybody since back in the days of Destiny 1 has thought, what if we could have an allied Fallen? You know, and Varix in Destiny 1 fulfilled that for us, sort of, because he was a vendor, but he was not really affiliated with us. But beyond all of that, we now have the possibility of it in-game. And he's one of the three major groups that's now vying for control of all of the remaining Fallen. And if he succeeds, the Fallen will no longer be enemies. They will be allies. You know, there will still be outcasts because that's the nature of the Fallen, but we will have a significant force at our side. That's such a huge story element they could tug on.
Think about, for a reference that I think all of us can kind of get down with, think about it like pirates out at sea, but you made an allegiance with certain pirates that are like, oh yeah, we actually want to be your friends. Like, we actually want to help you. We're going to help you on this. Like, we essentially met Jack Sparrow with, in a way. Yeah. And it's a very, very cool dynamic. And Zero Hour, if you haven't just played that mission, do yourself a favor, go and play it the whole way through. Go do every step for it and just play it. It's such a good.
Absolutely. The final of the three Fallen leaders, Eremis. Eremis is another really interesting character, and I feel like she's more of a seasonal story, but her story could also be the main villain that we're going to be plotted up against when we see anything to do with Mithrax, because she is kind of the in-between of Mithrax and Varix. She is trying to reignite the old House of Devils, and this is, you know, this is a really infamous house. This is the first house that really gave the city any big challenge in the form of the Battle of the Twilight Gap and the Battle of Six Fronts. You know, they were one of the major houses there, but they were always one of the most infamous. As a result, you know, her trying to revive this old school house and bring people to her banner is not something that anybody wants to take lightly. But she's also the reason that Zero Hour happens. And her and Mithrax, as a result, have sort of crossed blades metaphorically before. You know, like when there's that big captain at the end and when there's these enemies generally, you'll see that everyone has the title bound to Eremis.
All of that.
And this is, yeah, and this is literally a play of saying, like, these guys may wear the colors of the House of Dusk, but this is the newly reforming House of Devils. And she is really using all of this to sort of rise in status, become their Kel, and potentially steal back the major power that the Fallen power vacuum is offering her, you know? Yeah. And the big play and the reason why Outbreak perfected was even what was being gone after by the Fallen in that mission is purely because of the history that the House of Devils has with Siva. You know, at one point, the Splicers nearly had a plan that would have let them take over the last city again. And that's no small deal. So when you see them making these really big strides, and when you see anything to do with the Fallen generally, expect that Eremis may well be a really big point in the story. You know, like, she's not something that you're going to see on the side. If I bet you that if Mithrax appears, her or Varix will be an antagonist. And, you know, people may think of her as the smaller set of characters in there, but honestly, I'd say it's a 50-50, you know, like it's a coin flip. Right. You could even see all three.
You could see all three, and you could potentially see, because they are from different houses that still remain or are being started or whatever, you could potentially be seeing an all-out civil war between the Fallen in that regard, right? Because you would have all three of them trying to unite different Fallen to different causes. And because of that, because there's really no houses left, pretty much, for the most part, because of that, you could actually see a full-on civil war between the Fallen going on at the same time that we have this big falling out with the Darkness. And tell me, that would be so cool. That would be so cool. And that just gets me excited even.
It reminds me so much. I don't know if you've ever played StarCraft.
I have not, no. But I can tell you that a lot of Bungie devs have, and they take a lot of inspiration from World of Warcraft, StarCraft.
So StarCraft has a very interesting, let's go to StarCraft 2, because this happens multiple times during the history of the race in question. There's a race called the Protoss, and there are a whole load of different factions that make up the Protoss as a whole. And they are known as kind of a very long-lived, but, you know, slow to reproduce kind of race. And they're also one of these races that often has fallen into sort of factionalism. You know, this originally happened with the Dark Templar and the Standard Templar, so to speak, you know, your typical Protoss and those who decided that they didn't want to be a part of this thing called the Color. Law that's not necessary. But all of this leads us back to, you know, a further point that during the big climactic stuff at the end of StarCraft II's final expansion, you see what is effectively this big old civil war going on inside the Protoss, with one side supporting the ultimate darkness and another side, you know, trying to fight for peace. And that is then expressed through the conflict you have with a group called the Tal'Darim. You know, like, these are not unique ideas of saying, like, in the middle of all this chaos and in all of this nonsense to do with what is effectively an apocalypse, you're still seeing, you know, fractions of the population going out for their own interests, and factionalism emerges as one of the prominent forces driving motives. And it's, you know, like, it's so cool to still see this and potentially to have that with Fallen in Destiny.
And it just, and to me, it just makes sense in a way. Like, Fallen have lost pretty much everything. What else is there? What else is left for them other than one Fallen that is essentially a pirate trying to steal back their power? You have one Fallen who's has schemed his way to literally become a gigantic force of power that wants the old ways of the Fallen to return. And then you have a Fallen that wants to work with us to fight the bigger enemy. So I don't know. I think it's a really cool avenue.
But the point being, like, with all the different lore tidbits here, they've been building to this a lot. And it leads us to the beginning of even this season. Saint 14 actually has a conversation in one of the early lore transcripts from Bungie.net, and he's talking with Osiris, and Osiris tells him, by the way, watch out for the House of Light. If you can get a hold of them, see what you can do to support them. And this leads us to a really freaking cool story beat, and I really hope this happens, right? Saint 14, if he is ever inclined to do so, might end up teaming up with Mithrax. And for those of you who've played Destiny for a very long time, and for those of you who've played Halo, you know why that excites me. Because that's Arbiter and Master Chief all over again.
Except,
you know,
this time, the Master Chief can talk with a Russian accent.
Exactly. Like, you have the most infamous Slayer of the Fallen. Somebody who has effectively become a household name of hatred for the Elixni. And you have one of the outcasts, effectively, of mainstream Fallen society, who most definitely does not represent every single Fallen, but by that same token, maybe represents a more enlightened version of them. It's just, oh God, there's so much potential there for a fantastic story that you could tell.
It's going to be a great buddy cop story if it happens. Ultimately, yes. That is, yes.
Yeah. And also with those little signposts, it's not to say that it will happen, but even if we get just a little bit of interaction, there's so many great excuses to see that become one of the prevalent storylines in the next expansion. I don't know about you, but like, that's what it says to me. It says there's so much potential here for this to be what we all really fight around.
Yep. That, like, ultimately, I think it's going to be It's going to be a special one, I think. I really think no matter how it plays out this fall, it's ramping up to be a special one. So my question is, we talked about the darkness. We've talked about how the Taken probably aren't likely, how the Fallen are the most likely secondary story, like the B plot to the darkness's A plot, I guess, even though I personally think from like all the all the little like story quips and all that kind of stuff, it's a little bit more interesting to hear about like characters that have dynamics other than just this force that is the darkness, you know. So those are potential two plots. But what about the Cabal and Kallus? Because that was something that people keep bringing up through some 4chan stuff. And I obviously it's 4chan. You can't take anything it says for fact. But is there anything from the Kallus storyline that piques your interest?
So the one thing that I've been talking about a few times over the last couple of months is definitely Keitel. There is, you know, there's always been this fractious nature to the Cabal. And the major like point at which that's really played out for them has undoubtedly got to be the storyline of the Red Legion versus the Loyalists of Kallus. And that's getting a really new spin now because Kallus's daughter, Keitel, is sort of taking the reins of the Red Legion. And for those who don't know the context, Keitel was part of the Midnight Coup, which was this group. Well, it was an event, but also the coup conspirators were a group that effectively worked to dethrone Kallus so that Dominus Gaul could take over, right? And the Midnight Coup itself was something that was allowed to succeed by Keitel, and she's not been mentioned too much since. You know, like, she has suddenly reappeared with two very clear signposts in both the Fourth Horseman lore tab and the Heir Apparent lore tab, which is much more directly related to her. But yeah, it's very clear that now she's taken command of the Red Legion, and that will be the big question for us going forward, is how will Kallus and his daughter really develop the Cabal storyline? And realistically, do we actually want either of them to win? And considering that Kallus wants the darkness to take over, and considering that Keitel is literally going to be trying to take command of the Red Legion, who previously trapped the Traveler and stole our light, I don't think I want either of them to win, you know?
Like, yeah.
If it really does come down to it, the hilarious thing is we might just continue doing what we've been doing all this time, which is supporting Kallus because, hey, this guy's opulent. He can give us some nice loot, right?
I mean, you know? We're pretty much Kallus's janitor, you know? Kallus is like, yeah. Hey, I have a problem on the ship right now. I need you to take care of it. Okay, got it, buddy. And then all of a sudden, oh, wow, he hit me with some loot. All right, cool. Well, I kind of like this guy.
Cool, it's gold. It's got some jewels on it. All right, whatever.
But this is the same Kallus that raised a bather to wear a mask that he knew was made by Savathun and he knew was going to do something very bad, but was like, hey, I feel like testing this on a teenager. So indeed. This is the, like, Kallus is not by any means our friend. Just a figure he's that we have to
self-serving, very opportunistic.
He's a figure that we have to not put up with, but one that we're interested in because of the knowledge and because of the power that Kallus does have.
So yeah, like that, I think, is the really interesting story beat they could potentially be pulling on. And this is something to note about this generally. Luke Smith did say that they would have to try and cut back locations, or they'd have to trim down the size of the game. And effectively, what this means is that there's a real chance we could see the Leviathan going, right? Because if this storyline develops somewhere, and it turns out that there's going to be a big conflict between the two family members at the top of the Cabal hierarchy, we could see a fight for the Imperial Throne that demands that Kallus pulls the Leviathan back to Torah Battle. If that's going to happen, that's going to be really fascinating because, A, you know, there's potential for that to lead into like one or two missions where we accompany them or where we insert ourselves there. And, you know, that could be a cool chance to see the Cabal homeworld. But also, it gives Bungie that room to get rid of a location that contains four raids.
You know? And that's a lot of space. Yeah. Right? And, you know, I hate to see content go like that, but I'm also okay with something that nobody really plays going for at least a brief period of time. It could always come back in some kind of remastered And I would have to think that it would if they are going in that direction. But I feel like it wouldn't be the end of the world to lose Leviathan. I would be really sad about the Tribute Hall, because that's, I think, a really cool place just in general. But yeah,
the Tribute Hall and the Menagerie, I'd be very sad to lose.
Menagerie, I have some reservations
for that Crown of Sorrow. But when it comes down to the rest of it, I think it makes a lot of sense. Not many people will be playing Spire. Not many people will be playing Eater of Worlds. Not many people will be playing the original Leviathan Raid. There's not much reason to keep them around in terms of what's played.
And except for Sweatsicle to do a video on this versus Kalos.
Where it's constantly doing, like, how quickly can this new exotic murder things that we are able to slightly overlevel?
Exactly.
Which, in all fairness, for almost any exotic is like, if you've got a good enough team, yeah, you can do it.
You know? Pretty much. Yeah. If the idea is that if you can one plate Kalos, the exotic is good. If it takes more than one plate, it's probably not nearly as powerful. That's pretty much the idea. But yeah, I mean, like, I think it's a cool avenue, and I think it's something that would progress the story in a world that's supposed to be evolving all the time. That's what we were told, is that the world is evolving. Well, we can't have lore entries the way that we are without something big changing. It just wouldn't make sense. And the Leviathan is a potential avenue there.
Absolutely. I think also there's the, there's the kind of obvious point of, if they do this to the storyline, it means that the Cabal can take a moment where they graciously step back from being one of the major enemies in the story. Like, they have effectively been all year.
And
later date for better content or other content that, you know, satisfies the same story itch.
And I think we're all waiting for the day that the Cabal stop being the main enemy at this point. I think ultimately, I remember in Destiny 1 saying, oh, you know what would be great? A Cabal raid. And then we got hit with
Leviathan happened.
Leviathan, and then Eater of Worlds, even though you could say it's Vex, but I would also say that a lot of it is Cabal still. Spire of Stars is Cabal. I mean, Sundial was all Cabal. This season's storyline is Cabal. I think people have had enough of Cabal, so I mean, just for obvious reasons, I don't think.
Yeah. And I mean, you know, that then also lends to the idea that it would make a lot of sense for us to potentially slow down on the content there.
Exactly. And then, I don't know, Fallen content is always really welcomed. And then let's talk about the other main player, though, right? Because, like, we just covered the Cabal, right? We just covered the Fallen, we just covered the Taken. We haven't covered the Vex, nor the Hive. What is going on with at least one of those? I'll let you just go off of one.
So I think that when it comes down to it, the Vex and their storyline is something that could ultimately be pushed back. And the reason for that is because the Vex are this really nebulous enemy. They need to have a world where they're really well established, you know, a world like, say, Mercury or Nessus or Mars or something else. That's required for them to have a story beat at all. Right. And I don't know if we're going to see something like that for quite some time. It's always possible, but it's very much contextually required. Also, the Vex have not had a lot of story telegraphing for them recently that hasn't also been alongside the darkness. You know, when we went into the Black Garden and saw the Sol Divisive, that was the last time that we really saw like a lot of telegraphing to the Vex. We saw a little bit of interesting stuff of them. Admittedly, you know, we had an entire lore book that talked about how the Vex were potentially connected, and that other Vex, including the Hazen Lords of the Vault of Glass, feared the Sol Divisive because they were different and they were worshipping another power. You know, we've had those little hints here and there, and you even have moments where Praedith enters the story in a really big way, along with some copies of the original Ishtar Collective team. It's very deep lore, but it's such a great lore book.
Right.
But I don't think there's enough that necessarily telegraphs a major story event. You know, if anything, I'd say that the likely thing is that we see some kind of small ripple in time and we see Praedith momentarily. But I would not say that it would be anything huge. If anything, I'd say that it would be much more likely to see it as like, a story moment similar to Zero Hour. You know, I'd say you're looking at something which is much closer to a single mission with a really cool environment that you get to go to, and a moment where all of a sudden you have this new avenue for storytelling that's somewhat related to the story and somewhat not, you know? Like, Whisper was very much the one time when these missions were very closely tied to the story of the expansion in question. It was the direct end of Zol's story, you know? With Zero Hour, it was completely separate to Season of the Drifter.
It was kind of the start of a new Fallen story in a way.
Yeah. And the reality is we've not had, like, you know, a mission similar to those in a very long time. So maybe if we're going to see something happen on that front, maybe we get, I don't know, Vex Mythoclast back. Or maybe we get, say, the Stranger's Rifle back, considering that, you know, it's basically a retread of what Praedith sets loose within the time streams. Fun fact, by the way, there's another really interesting callback to the darkness there, because when we get our original weapon from the first from the like Praedith mission in Taken King, it's not the Stranger's Rifle, but there's another name for it.
The no time to explain. Yeah.
Yeah, and the actual like flavor text of that says two words are inscribed under the barrel or something, and it's "they're coming," and it's in reference to the darkness. So again, telegraphing.
Wow.
They go really far back with this stuff sometimes, and then they call back to it at other points in time. So this was very much one of those moments where they elevated an old piece of lore and, you know, confirmed it again in the canon of Destiny and said, like, hey, this is something that we've been planning for quite some time, or at very least, this is something that we can tie into the nature of it all, right?
Right. And
so, yeah.
Oh, my God. I totally forgot to bring up one of the beats that I wanted to bring up for a piece of evidence as to why the pyramids make sense to come back like this fall. You know, this is based off of concept art that's been in the game for so long. And it's the one that you're always going to see on the front of articles. But I want to specifically tell you why it's an important one and not just say, oh, hey, look, here's this. And this is a thing. It exists, you know? Right. So like in the picture, in this almost like H.R. Giger inspired art, right? Like it looks like Alien art. If you've ever seen the movie Alien.
Yes, absolutely.
It looks exactly like that kind of like architecture. But ultimately, what we're looking at is we see a statue. We see pyramids in the background, first of all, like way out in the background. You can actually make out the pyramids of that concept art. And then also on top of that, we have one of the we have the statue where we picked up the artifact in like the center of the concept art. You can see that statue. So if there was any indication that that concept art is just something, maybe it's not this fall, maybe it's in a different season or whatever, but it's something that they had been working on for a long time, or that this has been a story beat for a long time that they've had implications for, it's that. I mean, it is that.
You know, and aside from anything else, it fits the theme of the darkness too. Like, admittedly, the green is a bit of a departure from the red that we saw in Shadowkeep, but even so, the main monolithic kind of dark architecture with strange lines that are slightly embossed into it, but not much more that sets it apart. Sort of everything based on what you can see in the Divinity Exotic. Yeah, that's exactly the kind of architecture that is reflected in that image. Mm-hmm. So, it's very clear signposting again.
It's just very, very cool.
I think the last thing as well is really the Hive. Right.
Yep. And maybe, you know, the Scorn, you know, throw a little bone to the Scorn.
I don't know. I feel like the Scorn are going to take a back seat. Like, they could have some impact in the Fallen story.
They could be involved there, I guess.
You know, it's certainly something. The big telegraphing moment for all of them is definitely the fact that they're still in the Stolen Intelligence lore books. But basically, that justifies the existence of the Fanatic Strike. It basically says, we're continuing to run strikes against him. He has this ability to resurrect and regenerate, hence why we keep sending fire teams after him and why we keep suppressing him. I don't think that he's going to be a major player in all of this, but he's very much kind of opposed to every other Fallen House, because they all stand for the fallen in a sense of them actually being fallen. And in a very direct sense, the Fanatic does not want the Fallen to continue existing. He believes, much in the way that he used to when he was sort of met with Aldrin, he believes that the Fallen have kind of fallen out of their ways and that they basically need to be changed and they need to have a forced moment of evolution.
Yep.
So, yeah, stuff going on there. As for the Hive, their major story is undoubtedly going to continue with one of the big Hive gods. Whether that's one of the sisters, aka Savathun or Shiva or Raph, or whether it's some of the worm gods is not clear. But there aren't many other alternative players out there in the Hive storyline. The wild card for them, I would honestly say, is Toland. You know?
Yeah.
I'd say that your real question is how much does their storyline get impacted by Toland? I mean, this is the other thing as well. There's been a little signposting to this, too. Toland has an entire series of different patrols, though you can talk to him on the moon, and he talks about a whole variety of different events. He was also in the Dreaming City, so they've very much been establishing his character. And then beyond all of those happenings, you even get Saint 14 and Osiris talking about him, and they talk about him in a similar way to how there is a tiny bit of signposting about Mithrax and the House of Light in one of the early lore transcripts from this season. So you've got a character that's very much, I think, on the back burner, but I think, honestly, he is the most likely source of the next storyline. Like, clearly there's got to be a Hive God in tow, but I think that it's actually a really logical shoo-in if they want to do a story about the Hive, but they don't want to involve a Hive God. You know, and it's not to say that he hasn't had aspirations for godhood either. You know, there's for anybody who's way back in the Taken King, who's one of the OGs, you may remember there's literally a moment when you defeat Oryx for the first time before you kill him in the raid, where he says, "Do let me know if a vacancy opens with regards to Oryx's place in the Hive hierarchy." So, like, this guy has been scheming, you know? He's always looked at the Sword Logic as this true code of the universe, and he doesn't believe, even for a second, that this is going to be some moment where he's not going to, you know, jump in and take power, because he's like, why wouldn't I? Of course I would.
Of course, you know, and he's mad at us for not taking that power.
Yeah, he calls us squanderers, you know? Like, he admits that we're powerful, he calls us Sharp One as well, but he's very much irritated at us. And he sits there and he basically is facepalming whenever we don't take the greater power of the Hive, you know?
Mm.
So yeah, there's a lot of avenues to go down, but only Toland and Savathun have had a lot of signposting recently. And it's, I wouldn't say intense enough for us to talk about it in the same way as the Fallen. Like, the Fallen are way overdue for this, and I also think that it's been effectively signposted a whole bunch of different times. And also, we've got an entire season until September comes along. I would expect to see a lot of signposting. Like, open up Eververse on day one of the next season and look for anything that looks vaguely Fallen. And look and see if it has a lore tab. And I almost guarantee you that if one exists, it's going to signpost in this direction. Like, it has to. In fact, even in the latest freaking season, you know, we've got items that throw back to the Fallen, like the Orb Weaver shell. You know, like, this is not out of the question whatsoever. There's definitely room for a story like this.
And, you know, even going off of that a little bit more, right? Like, you could make the argument that, well, because I personally don't think Siva is going to be a major player. I don't think it will be. It doesn't make sense to me. I mean, but you could interpret the fact that there's a bunch of Siva items in the Eververse as, okay, Fallen signposting, right? Who is in control of Siva last? It Fallen. Like, ultimately,
I feel like we should have a drinking game for the word signposting. Like, whenever one of us says it, take a sip or something. And if ever we say it, like,
they just do it so much, we're gonna be alcoholics by the end.
Oh, dude, it's gonna be bad. But yeah, totally is, I think, is gotta be the next thing. And I think the next big point has gotta be location, right?
Yep. So we have our two most likely major players. One is, at this point, it's pretty much guaranteed that the next major player is going to be the Darkness, and the Fallen could be the B story. It's the most likely B story. Here is the other thing, though. With all this, there's probably going to be new locations, maybe returning locations. So I have my first pick, so I guess I'll just start with where we could potentially be going back to. I'll start with my going back to. Based off of everything that we have got in this game, and based off of just how many times we've already visited it, why wouldn't the Cosmodrome come back at this point? I feel like it's already pretty much formed, and I feel like it's something that you could explore more Fallen storylines, right? Like, it would be a place where the Fallen pretty much last reigned, right? The Plaguelands is a big part of the Cosmodrome.
So I'd not thought about that too much, but now that you pick up on it and say, like, why not? There is a lot to consider, you know? There's actually a really important sort of flag in the ground moment there for the Fallen story, because the House of Kings and the House of Devils were very much established and had major strongholds in the Cosmodrome. And if we're going to go ahead and see the Eremis storyline developed, we could see the Cosmodrome become a major battleground for the Fallen. You know, I could imagine something of, if there is this Fallen civil war going on, you know, we could have it playing up in the foreground, and we could see Mithrax or Varix trying to, you know, take on Eremis, who is effectively reclaiming the ancestral holds of her house and saying, you know, we are back. The banners that we burned 3 years ago have now been re-sewn and reforged, and we are stronger than we ever were. We are no longer weak.
Exactly.
And I think that's a powerful story moment, potentially, for anything to do with the Fallen. And you also make a really good point with Siva there. You know, like, when you sit down and you consider what the Fallen is searching for, you know, we may have destroyed the source of the Siva with the complex that we killed at the end of the Rise of Iron campaign. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, it's not to say that there isn't still a whole bunch of Warmind tech that they'd potentially be interested in. You know, like, the idea of splices hasn't gone away. You know, splices are still very much a part of the houses. It's just, I don't think you've seen one that's been able to grow in prominence in the same way that they did back in Rise of Iron. So it's not out of the question. I think the real question whenever you look at the Cosmodrome is there some way they can link in the Darkness story? Because, I mean, if there's anything more to do with Rasputin, maybe, like, he's got some big...
Yeah, Rasputin's main, one of his main bunkers is on the Cosmodrome, right? Like, one of the essential bunkers. Also, you know, this could literally have nothing to do with the story, but I feel like maybe there's that giant satellite that's in the Cosmodrome, and maybe they could reach out or use some kind of thing to let them know what's going on in the Darkness. I mean, that is, like, the biggest satellite that I've ever seen in Destiny, so that's not necessarily
the one from the Vanilla campaign in Destiny 1.
Which yes. Is just... And yes, then and then also you go up it in Cade's stash mission in the Taken King.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Where you go up into the colony ship?
No, you go up into the satellite, do you not? In Cade's stash.
Oh, so that's an unlocked Exodus craft.
Oh, yeah. And then there's the Master Chief Easter egg at the end. See? Told you. Master Chief, it all comes together.
Exactly. You got this guy. Yeah, no, totally.
So I mostly think the Cosmodrome, yes, story-wise, it makes sense with the Fallen mostly being housed there originally, and then also just Rasputin's bunker is, one of his main bunkers is down there, and that could be a really helpful resource going forward. But I also think there's just so many pieces that we already have. We have so many maps in this game that are based from the Cosmodrome. We have remastered areas like the Risk Runner Catalyst, if you didn't get the Risk Runner Catalyst.
Yeah, totally a thing. Like, yeah, no, they've already built a portion.
New Light players, their first mission is the first mission of the game. That's their mission.
Find an Arcadia, just like we did.
So, like, yeah. New Light players, it would make sense from their perspective, right? If they got the Cosmodrome, if they were like, okay, now I just go to the tower. Oh, wait, this isn't what I expected, right? Like, oh, what is this area? Why am I never going back to this? So it just would make sense from their perspective too, I guess.
It's worth noting, this is actually something that I know that a lot of endgame players might not necessarily see use out of, but for once, it's definitely not got to be about us. You know, like, if you look at what Destiny's free-to-play model demands, It demands that they improve the new light experience. And yeah, clearly they're going to do something for us. They're going to give us content. Like, that's out of the question. But when it comes to providing something for new players and maybe what might be, you know, viewed as either a nostalgic treat or maybe just a retread of old ground, they could potentially give up the Cosmodrome and just say, hey, we remastered this area and it's entirely for the new lights. But if you're an old school player, you can still use this as a patrol location. The flashpoint will still be here if you're in leveling. Like, go have at it. There'll be some story beats here, maybe, like, if they are going to expand on the Fallen story in the way that we speculate. But, you know, like, that could be such a cool idea if they do it right. And, you know, I wonder what the, like, sentiment shift there is going to be, because there's always going to be that conversation about whether it's like, hey, is this just reskinning or is this, you know, adding something new? And I think that's the big question surrounding a location like the Cosmodrome, but I don't think it's out of the question. I don't think it would be bad either. You know, right. Like, it presents really relevant story opportunities.
I from my perspective, if they were to bring back a location, it would have to be the Cosmodrome. Like, that's just my, if they're going to bring something back, it's going to be the Cosmodrome. It wouldn't make sense. I know a lot of people say, like, what about the Dreadnought? It's just floating there. Nobody's claimed Oryx's throne.
If they'd had more like Hive telegraphing and
exactly
stuff like that.
then I would say the Dreadnought, but the Cosmodrome, it's like, okay, we have Fallen telegraphing, we have Rasputin telegraphing, we have Rasputin's story, we have Darkness telegraphing, like, all those things line up to, oh, the Cosmodrome could become a returning player. The other place that I was thinking, not for a return, but for a new location. What were you thinking for a new location?
I have a feeling that this is definitely going to be ground that people have trodden before, and I feel like this is going to be the generic suggestion when it comes down to it. But I feel like at this point, with all the concept art they've had of it, and with all the different like looks into story beats, they've got to do something with the idea of Europa. You know, it's been a piece of concept art for God knows how long. I feel like it's back since the days of Destiny 1.
It was before Destiny even came out, yeah.
Yeah, and beyond all of that, if we are going to open up a front to fight the darkness, it makes a whole lot of sense, right? Not because of the fact that it's, you know, a world with some particular alignment. No, nothing like that. But because of the fact that it's in proximity to it. Look at the Doomsday Clock in the bunkers, right? They are engaging in a pattern where they are going to be at Saturn in 3 weeks' time. You know, and if we are going to have a fight that opens up in this war against the darkness, we may look to take them on a world that is actually close to where the heart of their fleet is. And Europa, Ganymede, Calypso, a whole bunch of these worlds make a lot of sense. If Io hadn't been a world, I would have speculated Io, but at this point, Europa is just seemingly, it kind of needs to get done. You know, like, it's been on the chopping block for so long, as far as story locations are concerned, that we just haven't seen in game yet. And I feel like it would be weird at this point if we didn't see it, you know?
Yeah, so, and not to even mention that, right? Like, here's another, like, reason story beat-wise why it could happen. Europa has the Deepstone Crypt, if I'm not mistaken. That is, birthplace of Exos?
So, this is something which potentially relates back to Cade's journal, right? If you're going to look at what's going on, you can look at the last kind of paragraph from the Taken King Collector's Edition. And Cade has a moment where he's talking about all these different things. Actually, it's not the last paragraph. It's one of the first ones. The last paragraph is him experiencing the collapse. The first paragraph, or one of the early paragraphs, is him talking about what we presume is an experience in the Deepstone Crypt. And he says somewhere cold, you know, he talks about this. And it's very much hinting towards an ice world, which is what Europa would be. And I think, let me double check to make sure, because it's been a hot second since I've read this. If you guys go into the equipment for the last season, as in this season, I want to say it's something to do with the solar sails, the exotic ship. I'd need to go ahead and read this again. But from what I can see, they talk, yeah, here it is. This is the line. Wish we were going to Titan instead. Hell, anywhere but Europa. Was hoping, you know, like they literally give us a name drop there and say, like, hey, this ship is very much related to what's going on. they say they would they don't want to spend their summer in a frozen tundra, mm-hmm. you know? So it's not just name dropping in a recent shit, but also it gives us a potential reason to sort of talk about what's going on. It says like, hey, there may be stuff going on there. If I'm not mistaken, that's actually related to Bray Tech stuff as well. I'm going to hide in a corner from the Scorn while I do this.
I swore yeah. that it had to do with Bray Tech. Yeah. And,
yeah.
And honestly, I think as crazy as this sounds, if it has to do with Bray Tech, if it is a place where Exos are from, then why wouldn't we see a potential return of the Stranger?
Hmm.
As a major player that could A, warn us of the darkness, B, assist us in some way of helping, because she's been studying the darkness this whole time, presumably. I feel like the cards line up for Europa more than a lot of other places, because that's yeah. where they're going story-wise. Now, I don't know where the Fallen fall into Europa. I don't know if there's already Fallen that have been established to be on Europa. That I have no clue about, but that could be a potential avenue. That could be a war zone. What?
How did we die?
Oh.
Did someone run ahead?
Yeah.
Someone ran ahead. I was outside fighting things, and then my Fades Away screen came up. I was
Huh?
What do you mean we're dead? This doesn't make sense. But yeah, I mean, this is the cool thing about Fallen if you're trying to fit them into a storyline. They are literally related in some of their first lore, and you can see this just from the number of locations they populate, as having really versatile physiology, which is basically to say they can survive in a whole range of atmospheres, of planetary atmospheric distributions, of different pressures. All these different kinds of world can be kind of settled by the Fallen. You know, you see them on Earth, you see them on Titan, you see them on Venus, you see them all over the place. And it's not to say that then a moon like Europa is any different. You know, the extreme cold is not necessarily something that will hold the Fallen back. Oh, I didn't expect to catch that. I'm not gonna lie. they fit in as far as the actual physiology of them is concerned. But if this is a new front being opened up in the war against the darkness, and if that Saint 14 little bit of telegraphing that we got from the beginning of the season is correct, and, you know, him and Mithrax are potentially going to be looking to work together, you have a really cool opportunity to tell a great story about how, like, there's a united front now with the Guardians and the House of Light working together. So ultimately, yeah, like, really, really cool potential for all of this. And I do want to see if that's going to be the case, because I feel like it would be totally wild if you see all of those potential story beats line up together. You know, suddenly this, the desperation of circumstances forces this awoken, awoken kind of as well, because we do sort of have the Queen on our side, awoken human fallen alliance to come together. And I'd really love to see that. You know, it would be such a cool moment in the storyline.
It would be a big change. Yeah, it would be really cool to see like another place united, and maybe even if it does turn out where, you know, in our hypothetical scenario of Mithrax, Varix, and Aramis fighting, in this hypothetical scenario, doesn't it seem like, okay, that could be our first potential story close? Other than, you know what I mean? Like our first potential, okay, Fallen have united under X. Or maybe it ends terribly and Mithrax completely loses, Aramis wins, and we have more to even go off of with the Fallen, and we just keep going down the rabbit hole. But I feel like that's one of the biggest points of, not criticism, but one of the biggest points that Bungie has been kind of told about by the fan base is like,
we need to tie up a story.
We need to finish a story.
There
yeah.
are so many loose ends, and we are getting to that point where it's becoming a little bit cumbersome. You know,
we're getting like, exactly. And I think this could be the opportunity to end a story with essentially one of the four major enemies in the game. Not like, okay, here's the Scorn, even though the Scorn have pretty much been wrapped up, but like, okay, here's the Fallen. And now this main enemy that once was very angry at you because you took what they thought was theirs has now finished their storyline, and they've now run through that character arc of, okay, now we're not going to be as mad about it. don't know. Right? I think it's a cool beat.
Now they're your allies, you know? Like, that's kind of, it's not, so to speak, the end of the Elite story for Halo 3, because, you know, or Halo 2, rather, because that breaches over into Halo 3. But it follows a very similar line of saying that. And, you know, there's still very much going to be those dissident houses here and there. It's not like the House of Dusk is going to roll away anytime soon. Like, it's an entire population that has to get used to this idea. It's not going to be a one-day event, but it is very much going to be a capstone to that story.
Exactly. Speaking
of which, I know we're on destinations right now, and there are a few other things potentially that signpost us towards Europa right now, but... And this is a really important one.
Mm-hmm.
On the note of tying up loose ends, Aldrin.
They need to do something
about Aldrin and the Hunters. And again, telegraphing on at least the side of the Hunter Dare thing, right? Like, I previously talked about how there hasn't been any Aldrin telegraphing since the Dawning. And that's kind of true. But by that same token, there's very much been telegraphing about the fact that the Hunters are in a big old mess right now. They need a Vanguard really badly.
They need somebody to rally behind, yeah.
Yeah, so I think that if we're going to see all of this come together, it might be a moment at which we see his storyline reemerge. And given that the Darkness is coming along, it might be a perfect time for him to sort of show that he can be redeemed, you know? Like, I can't imagine the circumstances for this, but imagine he does something and takes down a pyramid ship or some nonsense like that. If ever there was a clearer way of saying, I am not an ally of the Darkness, I'm your ally, I don't think it exists. It's something like that that's going to happen.
Right. You know? And, I mean, we've been basically been kind of like speculating that he's going to be the new Hunter Vanguard forever. And we keep seeing little traces of him here and there. And Bungie wouldn't put in a full-on cutscene of him coming back to life if it didn't have important significance to the story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like, it's just not been touched for ages. And I feel like at some point they're going to have to revisit that.
So with that being said, with Aldrin being a potential main player also, right? We are looking at, based on our hypothetical... the biggest expansion story-wise ever made. I think so, right? Like, based on...
It's a lot.
we got the Darkness, who's just this glooming main antagonist in the overall scheme. We have the Fallen, who are having a complete falling out. Not... Okay, no pun intended there. We have Aldrin, who needs to redeem himself and prove why he's not evil. We have potentially the Stranger, who could have something to do with what's going on in Europa or can guide us in a way. We have Mara Sov that's been talking about this forever. We have Osiris and Saint 14. All these major players could tie into one potential storyline. And wouldn't that just be... I don't want to get
crazy.
That sounds just... It doesn't... But the thing is, normally I would say that sounds unbelievable. But in this case, based on the evidence that we've been given in the lore, and based on what Bungie is pretty much going to have to do in the eyes of a lot of the fan base to regain a lot of the hope and trust and just all that kind of stuff, I feel like they're going to come out fully swinging. It's that every other year expansion. It's that Forsaken, Taken King type of year.
And we are in that weird place of having, like, you know, it's been a hot minute. And I think that ultimately, with all of the telegraphing there and with the amount of work that may well have gone into what's coming next, they have a lot that they don't have to worry about now.
Exactly.
So, you know, it's okay. That requires a little context. Previously, they had to create New Light entirely. Right? They had to completely revamp everything there. They also had to worry about a Steam transition from one platform to another and the breakup with Activision. Like, these are all major things that would have had to fill their timetable. Now they don't need to worry about that stuff. They've charted their course. They kind of know what they're doing. May be in a better place for all of this. And maybe that doesn't take a bunch of time away from development. I'm not sure, but you know, whatever it may be, there's going to be big stuff happening regardless.
It's going to be very, 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 very exciting. Is there, okay, so we covered we covered enemies, we've covered locations. Is there anything else left to cover for what could be potentially coming?
Yes. So this is something that I don't know if by the time this is uploaded, the video will be released or not, but just in case, I'm going to go ahead and talk about this anyway. In the last like few days, I've been reading back through a whole bunch of different lore over the last couple of seasons, and there is something that might not be in September, but could well have an impact and an effect from some point very close. Sort of think of this as maybe something to do with the next season. Have you read the Trials and Tribulations lore book? That's where we'll start.
So I haven't got the chance to read it, but I want to say that every single headline says what we're doing in Trials of Osiris is
what we were doing in Trials of Osiris in the old Trials of D1. Yes. Having said that, you definitely shouldn't trust the lighthouses. But there is something that connects this to some lore that we got at the very beginning of the season, and something that I think we might even have had signposting for all the way back from in Season of Dawn. Originally, we got a lore book, which was called The Pigeon and the Phoenix, and I believe it's in Dusk and Dawn. Oh, never mind, it's not. It's in the light. Yeah, it's got to be in the light side of things.
Is that the one? Is Pigeon and the Phoenix from the Corridors of Time?
It is indeed from the Corridors of Time.
I'm very familiar with that.
And it goes, what do you mean? You have no experience in there. You didn't spend an hour in there at all.
No. And 6 days of no sleep.
Oh, I'm so glad that I got sleep during that time. But anyway, the Corridors of Time gave us this lore book, right? And this lore book details the story of Osiris and Saint 14 through various different points in time. And Osiris, in two of the different entries, meditates. And during these meditations, he sees a point of light in a void of darkness and stillness, right? Just a singular point of light. Then we go all the way forward. And I just want you to keep that like little point in mind, you know, this singular spit of light in that vacuum of darkness. I just want you to remember that and set it aside for a moment. We then got the cutscene at the very end of Season of Dawn, where Osiris was confronting Rasputin, being like, whose side are you on? There's an addendum and a follow-up to all of that that happens in the early, pre-season lore for Season of the Worthy. And it contains a moment where Rasputin feeds coordinates and data to Osiris, and Osiris basically follows them. Now, the progression is really weird, because Osiris's ship then starts close to the sun, and he then plots a course out to the heliopause. For those of you who aren't like clued up on your intersystem planetary geography, so to speak, and your astronomy, the heliopause is basically past Neptune. You know, it's where you'll find planets, or planetoids rather, such as Pluto and Eris, and objects that just rotate around the sun, but they're not large enough or close enough to be classified as planets. He's all the way out here. And keep in mind, this at this moment in time is probably where the darkness is, right? Mm-hmm. He goes there and finds a weird gravitational mass. Sagira, his ghost, then starts acting in the very same way that our ghost did when he was in proximity to the darkness, right? He starts to experience this moment of big unease, and it's not really very easy for him to do much. Sagira gets very weakened, and she stays with the ship. Osiris then ventures out and pushes off against the ship, and as best as I can tell, he goes into some kind of welcoming dark void. And for all we know, this could be some moment where it's just the presence of the darkness, or it could actually be a pyramid ship that he enters. It's very much abstract writing. There's not a lot of clear moments at which it indicates what's going on, but it's definitely a dark shadow that he's entering into. Osiris then has a moment inside this place where he sends forth echoes. Now, I want to be really clear. There's a very important distinction here. Osiris has echoes and he has reflections. The reflections are the things you saw in the Curse of Osiris story campaign. You know, they're the copies of him that are all gold and shimmery. His echoes are different. He uses them to chart out the sundial. And I've actually made mistakes in previous lore videos talking about this, because it was only pointed out that they were different in the Season of the Worthy lore. and I believe the terms were interchangeable, he defines them as being different for Saint 14. He states that they're more similar to what the Taken King would use to navigate that geometry. And the echoes don't get as much resistance inside this place. They're able to go out and somewhat chart it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's troubling from the start. He then finds a single point of light in all of this, and he finds, lo and behold, some kind of point at which, instead of it being further away from him and infinitely regressing, a moment where it ends. And it ends in this strange metallic seat that he picks up and then just takes out of the ship. It starts to sort of like become a lot more climactic and a lot more terrifying. And yeah, he basically just starts to leave. He then wakes back up and he's back around the sun, very close to the sun, and Sagira acts as though it's never happened, but he's still holding this seed, right? So that's a crazy story in the first place.
So
right?
One of the things you also told me about that story, right? I don't know if I didn't hear it this time around, but you told me that Sagira was acting like our ghost on the final mission of the Shadowkeep campaign.
Final mission in terms of like before entering the ship. That's worth context.
Before she entering gets really the ship,
weak and becomes sort of stuttery. She doesn't speak for the darkness, as best I can tell.
Right. You she. Know? She just gets really weak, like, I'm losing power to this thing, whatever it is. So
it's very clear that there's discomfort there, and something is disconcerting, right? She yes. stays with the ship. She slumps on his shoulder, right? So something's going on there. This is where Trials and Tribulations comes in, though, right? Brother Vance goes and visits Queen Mara Solve, and this is way back during the days of Destiny 1 Trials, right? This is just recorded in the Destiny 2 Trials lore book. She then says, when you next see our mutual friend, when she's talking about Osiris there, she gives him a set of instructions. And it's not actually listed in the exact lore card, but later you find out that that set of instructions was clearly to tell Osiris to, quote, plant the seed. And this all then comes into the context of him having plucked this, quote, metallic seed from what it could be a darkness ship. And all of this is also keeping in mind that Mara Solve has sort of premonitions of the future. She saw her death at the hand of Oryx. She may understand where the future is going, and she may have seen this as some way of forestalling things. My big question then becomes, where the hell does this storyline go, and what the hell is the seed?
Like, what is this thing?
And how much damage could it do? How terrifying could this be? Why did Osiris steal it from this terrible dark void? What's going on? You know?
Well, it just reminds me of the artifact that we got at the end of the Shadowkeep campaign, too. It's a metallic seed-like thing that kind of resembles the Traveler, right? So,
indeed. The description of it is as kind of like a single pinprick of light.
Yeah.
I need to go ahead and look up the exact tab for that, which is in... I need to remember what the title of that law entry is. You can find it at the very beginning. What gives me pause? There we go. That's the name of it. If you want to find it on Bungie.net, or if you just want to read it, I'll go ahead and link it in the description. But yeah, I think that that could contain a really significant sort of moment in the story for the next season. Because now they've kind of hinted towards it, not just in a small moment in the Season of Dawn, potentially, if those two sort of pinpricks of light are the same, but also they've hinted at it a lot in Season of the Worthy. Like, there's so much potential for that to be a really big moment.
Oh yeah, definitely. And if there's an avenue for, okay, the darkness is coming, what are they after? That's my other question, actually. What is the darkness after they come here? Just to reign supreme and to kill the Traveler? Like, what is the motivations of our enemy?
So this is one which you can kind of find all the way back from the sort of vague mythos of the darkness. But beyond all of it, there's also a lot that's talked about in the Unveiling lore book. There's a lot that's talked about through just generic Hive lore when you see any references to the sword logic. You can go back and you can see a whole bunch of different story notes that really do reference the idea that the darkness desires strong life to conquer and to prevail. And they have been chasing the Traveler ever since. I'd also look at Pujari, and his teachings. Like, I whitter on about this, if anybody has really watched my videos, a whole ton. But I believe that he is the closest to being absolutely correct about the nature of the darkness, in the idea that the darkness is symmetrical to the light, right? So when the darkness awoke, it was because of a wave of light that came from the Traveler's Awakening, and it suddenly became active again, you know? And that speaks to me of this idea of the darkness and light are in balance and in symmetry. And the darkness is either trying to upset that balance, or alternatively is trying to destroy the Traveler and make it go back to sleep and eventually cause more entropy for the universe. Because ultimately the sword logic and the way of their power is something that will lead to the death of everything but what is strong in the universe, you know? And the Traveler's way of creating life and blooming new worlds before us is actually a way of defying that. They refer to themselves in the Unveiling Lore book, or at least the darkness refers to the two of them, as the gardener and the winnower, right? So there's this cycle of almost samsara to them, life and death in perpetuity together. And I think that if anything is going on, it's got to do with that delicate balance. But I also wouldn't trust a single thing that the darkness tells us that it wants, you know?
Right. Because that's from their perspective, whatever they're going to say. Like, why would we, exactly. In the same right. sense that why are we trusting truth to power?
Exactly. Right. Like, I mean, you know, it could be that, yes, they're a supreme being and lying is beneath them. Sure. Like, totally possible. I don't put that past the possibility whatsoever. But why would you not lie if it gives you an advantage? The very idea of what the darkness does is all about creating moments of advantage for itself or for any of its practitioners. So it doesn't make any sense to me that it wouldn't be trying to do everything in its power that it sees would be advantageous from its perspective, you know? Mm-hmm. I think it's very much been trying to turn guardians for a long time, and it even has moments where it's done that in the past. If you've read the story of the Kentark Three, the fire team that entered the Black Garden and whose army you recover from the Garden of Salvation raid, you know, their story and how it's wrapped up with the divinity, It all talks about how basically it all fell apart for them when they were all spoken to by darkness and when they kind of tacitly accepted dark power and their ghosts fell down motionless as a result. You know, so I wouldn't trust the darkness, but I also don't know quite where it stands in the story because it's really hard to know what to trust.
Right.
As the Nine would say, you know, it's a little bit like an ant trying to understand a human being. Like, admittedly, their frame of reference for it is about a human trying to understand the complexities of a being made of dark matter. But for us, trying to understand a literal god, even if we are demigods and even if we've killed gods before, it's hard, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, our understanding of Oryx fundamentally changed when we realized that he could live on through us killing him, thanks to the calcified fragments and the touch of malice. That ultimately changed him into a fantastic character beyond what he already was, because, you know, it was this moment where even in death he was victorious. He had ascended past what he existed as, and he was already a god, right? Like, these are beings that are playing games within games. We are,
they're 20 steps ahead. Yeah. So the darkness is motivation. We wouldn't know until it happens, but You said something that I remember reading in that 4chan thing, and I want to just silence the 4chan stuff. You said the word winnower. I believe that was mentioned in that post. Mm-hmm. Is that just another name for what the darkness represents, is the winnower?
Potentially. The gardener and the winnower was referenced in the Unveiling Lore book. So it could be that if there's a leak that borrows from anything, it could just be using that as a way of like signposting itself and saying, oh, look, it was referenced
exactly
before. That's totally correct, right, guys?
Right. I just wanted to point that out because I know people are going to probably say something about, oh, in the 4chan thing, there was, you know what I mean? Like, right. Ultimately.
I don't know about you, but we've both been around this community for ages.
Yeah.
Right. And it's not the first time we've seen a leak about a big expansion that it didn't pan out, right? Like, even if it does pan out, it's worth knowing that just because somebody says a little reference to something and just because somebody signposts a thing with a name that we all recognize doesn't necessarily mean that it's true. That could just very much be someone trying to lend legitimacy to their claims because they know the law.
Right.
And their claims might actually just be a load of nonsense. So, it's hard to prove this stuff.
Slayeridge actually made a really good video. I'll put a link to that one. Slayeridge made this amazing video basically breaking down 4chan leaks in general and how they really make us excited because they're things that A, we've wanted, B, things that are just like things that have been glooming in the background, C, even if they do come true, it's still just like somebody's word versus what's actually going to happen. And ultimately, we shouldn't trust any of that, but it does make people excited, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And maybe some of it turns out to be true, maybe some of it isn't. I generally, as a rule, when it comes to leakers, I just try and avoid them now. And that's not in terms of I actively, ignore them in terms of I don't know how best to put it. I don't seek them out in the same way that I used to. And I don't comment on them mm-hmm. when it comes to the YouTube channel. I respect the fact that most people just don't want to be spoiled now. And I know that there's a whole ton of people out there, but ultimately my priority when it comes to it is if I hear the information, yeah, sure, whatever, I don't mind. But my priority is making sure that whenever the information is out there that I'm effectively doing my part to quarantine it, you know?
Right, and whether
it's true or not, it's keep it under wraps because there's going to be someone out there who gets spoiled by it potentially. And nobody was happy about Snape kills Dumbledore when that nonsense went down, and this would be the same case for some people, you know?
Yeah. And that's why I wanted to bring you on for this video to begin with, is literally because if we use supporting evidence based on facts that are in the game, past things that have happened in the game, we can make our best educated guess without... We can science this. You know what? We're going to science this.
This is Datto in the vault.
Destiny, you know? Science time, yes.
This is why you have data. This is why you test.
I mean, ultimately, when it comes down to it, though, it's important to make sure that the integrity of what we're doing here is not is to try to steer everybody in the best possible direction, because we're all excited, but we don't want to straight up just say something without any proof or without any supporting evidence. Really important to do.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. It's part of the reason why I think this is a really nice opportunity as well, because this is a meeting of the minds to a certain extent, right? I do the lore of all the fictional nonsense that's happened around Destiny and its story, and you talk about the very real history of Destiny and its story. And so for us to bring the two sort of sets of knowledge together, it makes for, I'd say, a really kind of killer presentation, potentially.
Agreed.
At least I hope you guys think this has been good. Let us know in the comments if you just think this has been a whole load of nonsense. But yeah. Hopefully it has been to your satisfaction.
Yeah. Can you think of any other big major outlier questions? Because I am starting to stumble on things at this point. Have we pretty much covered everything?
I think you brought up, and I think this is probably one of the last moments where we'll return to Europa and the Exo Stranger and the potential tie-in there. The big missing piece of that puzzle is potentially Clovis Bray. Now, I know there's a little bit of debate in the community as to whether it was truly confirmed as to whether Elsie Bray was the Exo Stranger. So let's go ahead and let's just keep that in mind. Yes, there's a lot of really definitive evidence that points that way, but it's not truly there. I would sit there and I would say that if there's any moment where we get a bit that states Europa saw the advent of Clovis Bray there in some form, we've absolutely got our number for Europa, because there's been a lot of stuff to do with Clovis Bray and their past experiments. You know, one of the early lore bits that we got as kind of a prelude to all of this was very much to do with Anna Bray basically discovering what was known as a deep stone crypt, you know. And yeah, this is a really interesting distinction, because she discovers it on Mars, but it's noted that I believe this is something I'd need to reread again because it's been a hot minute, but it's noted that it's just a facility where there are a bunch of exos and that there is a distinct connection to Rasputin. So this is the really interesting point if we see something referencing Clovis Bray in all of that mess, I think you've got your number for it. And I think it's almost inevitable that we're going to see something. Whether that actually ties back into Elsie or not, I don't know. But if she's arriving at the time when the darkness is coming back, I'd say it makes the most sense. Again, it all assumes that she is the Exo Stranger, which, again, seems more
likely. Lots of evidence points that way, but, you know, until it's officially, hello, I am the Exo Stranger, yes, my name is Elsie Bray, we don't know for sure.
It's, you know, like, until we have a moment where it's like, it's time to explain.
So I actually wanted to go to Io and go down to the bunker, because I want to make sure of something that would also tie to the Europa potential. I'm pretty sure on the Io map of where all the pyramids are coming in, isn't Europa listed as one of the places on here?
And I mean, do you speak Russian?
Of course, yes, fluent. I learned it from my cousin Nikolai, you know? Let's see.
Nico, let's go bowling.
I'm like 99% sure that whatever... I don't know what this is right here, but I remember seeing a graphic on Twitter that this looks like Europa, right? Is that not...
So I would expect that to be Saturn and Titan.
This is Saturn? Right?
Yeah.
Because okay. Oh, Titan right there. Yeah. Yeah. Because of the...
Yeah. Again, Saturn is the seventh planet out from the sun, and then Titan is its, you know, it certainly is its largest moon. So it makes sense for the two of them to be listed. As for Jupiter back here, I would expect that to be either Ganymede or Io, considering the length of the word in Russian. I'd think Io, but I don't speak Russian, so this is all...
Rasputin, yeah, why you got to do it to us?
To use an inappropriate phrase. But yeah, like, watch this space, because this is only the beginning.
Yeah, this and every single week, these Doritos keep getting just a little bit closer. Fun fact, I don't know if you knew this, but here, come here. Aim in at these monitors and try to move around. Oh, yeah. Rasputin is always looking at you.
Yeah, it's really cool. It's one of the neatest little bits of like environmental sort of quirks that they've added to this.
So cool.
Yeah. Shout out to 900s and her team who basically made this happen, by the way. It's a really cool feature of the bunker.
Super, super cool.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I can't really, like, without, because I don't want to talk about the other potential spoilers that can be coming with this community quest that's going on. I don't want to talk about that until that's out, because we do like a full coverage on that. But it's going to be interesting, sure.
Yeah, there's a lot of cool things that we can potentially see happening in the future. And I think now it's just a case of like waiting and seeing what Bungie delivers, because inevitably, and this is kind of referencing historical stuff, by this time, 2 years ago, we were starting to see the previews of Forsaken. You know, by this time, 1 year ago, we were seeing the previews of Shadowkeep. So I think we are going to hear about this expansion very soon. You know, like, I'd give it, in fact, honestly, considering that it's been around about May 5th on both instances, for both Shadowkeep and for Forsaken, when we heard about them, I'd say you could even hear about it in the next few days.
Yeah.
I find that unlikely, because we're already seeing, like, further stories about the darkness proceeding in the bunker week by week. So you might want to wait and see what happens with that. But I would not be surprised if something really big gets announced very soon.
I wouldn't be surprised if it's right when this community event ends, we get the big trailer for this fall, or we get some kind of big tease, like a poster or something. As crazy as that sounds, even though we have a whole new season next season, it just rings well that like this fall they would be teasing around this time, because it's either May or June for every single big fall expansion is when you get the big teaser. So we could be complete idiots. This could be going to the Dreadnought. This could be going to many other places. And we just told you what, 2 hours of just hypotheticals.
2 hours that aren't of in Europa, and it turns out no, it's going to be Savathun, and she's like the envoy of all the darkness nonsense. Like, okay, yeah, that's possible, and that would, you know, I'd eat a whole bunch of humble pie if that was the case, and do so quite happily. But you know, we'll see. Oh, we will see. We will see. But yeah.
That's
exciting potential for all of this.
Honestly, I'm very, very juiced for whatever the outcome is. It's going to be amazing. I would pin this in my opinion. You know, I don't want to get too hyped, but my opinion is based on the every other year is a big, big expansion, and based on Bungie official, I would say this is the first official year of like everything completely free, because you usually make content in the future when you're under, you know, even when they were under Activision, usually make content in the future. I would say this upcoming year is going to be, I don't want to use the words the big one, because we use that every single time we talk about these things, but man, it's got me excited. There's so many avenues. We're fighting so many potential amazing.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. I think that kind of brings us to a close quite neatly, doesn't it?
Yeah. You know, ran a bunker at the end just to just close it out.
Seasonal content, dude. Yes. Seasonal content.
Of course.
Great.
Fun.
But yeah, no. Let us know if you want more of these videos down below in the comments section, by the way, guys, because this is very much one of those moments where we could go ahead and do this every other season or every 3 months or something like that if this goes off really well. But yeah, this is, I think it's a really cool potential idea. Let's just go ahead and talk about what might be happening next. And I feel like it may work out best when we sort of like are just on the cusp of a future thing, because we can look at everything with kind of unspoiled eyes, so to speak. And yep, we can look at all of the signs that we might want to pick apart before we get the massive trailer and we were like, oh, well, of course it was going to be this, you know? Like, this gives us an opportunity to really analyze all the avenues of the game.
Right, when everybody, when it's like kind of a low point, but everybody's excited for what's next, I'd say that's like the perfect time that we would want to consider doing.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. But anyway, yeah, I think that's going to be it. So I don't know if we want to do like a dual sign off on this, or we want to record it individually.
I mean, you know what? Let's do a dual sign off, and then we can record ours individually if it goes terribly. And then we can cut this part and pretend like we never did a dual sign off at all.
Ah, the magic of editing.
So yeah, thank you guys so much for watching. Of course, go check out Bife. If you don't know who Bife is, literally, I'm going to give you a very friendly smack to the head. Go watch Bife, please. And yeah, if you guys did like the video, you want to consider supporting, you can find me on my Twitch channel, or you can find me on YouTube, EvanF1997. Bife, where are you at?
I am on YouTube.com/MyNameIsBife. And also, you can find me on Twitter, which is just @MyNameIsBife. Those are the two main platforms where I'll be going ahead and doing my stuff. Also, go ahead and follow Evan. Evan's really sort of come to prominence within the last like year's worth of time in Destiny. And he is effectively, as I was saying earlier, the historian of what happened in the real world of Destiny and the community and all of the cool events that our community has seen. If you want to learn about the one time when Savathun basically pulled the wool over our eyes with the 999 power incident, and how Truth to Power was basically a whole bunch of lies, Evan's got a write-up on it. If you want to go ahead and talk about the first 24 hours of Last Witch, which is one of my favorite ones of your videos, by the way,
he's got
a review of all the stuff that happened. If you want to talk about something such as, say, the early exotic puzzles that we got back in Destiny 1, such as, say, the Touch of Malice, or the crazy ARG plus gameplay extravaganza that led us to Outbreak Prime, all of that is on his channel, and it all goes through the real history of Destiny's events and the emotions that everyone was feeling, what had to happen in the process of things. It really is chronicling the great events of our community, and what I may do for the story of the game, Evan does for the story of the players. So yeah, go ahead, check him out. He's very much somebody that you will want to you'll want to keep subscribed to in the future. He is the chronicler of the community in the same way that I'm the chronicler of the story. So yeah.
Sounds good. Everybody, thank you so much for watching. And until next time, let us know what you think. Let us know if you want us to keep doing these. Seriously, this was a lot of fun. Thank you so much for coming on, Bife.
Absolutely. And to everybody else who's watching at home, know that, as per usual, your viewership is quite enough for me. But in the meantime, my name has been My Name Is Bife. Rodacia Ad Astra. I'll see you starside.
Goodbye, everyone.